டென்ஷன் ஆயிடுது.
How can IoT be made environment friendly and also, you know, of course IoT is making our lives much, much easier, but that alone may not be sufficient. It should also save our environment, right? So today we're going to see, but before that, you know, the toughest task is being a speaker on the last day, because many of them would have covered almost all the topics that I think of speaking, but still I have come with full confidence, thinking that the participants would help me, you know, to take forward in the session by participating very energetically. Okay, so
I stop sharing, ma'am. You can proceed with ma'am. Thank you.
I'll start sharing. Thank you, dear participants, for joining this STTP. And let me start my presentation. Okay, so as I said, my presentation is going to be around green IoT, but you know, I cannot straight away start with green IoT. So what I have planned for today is, let me start with my own way of introduction to IoT and architecture. Okay, and then I'll be speaking a little about the hardware processes of IoT in my own style, okay, which I'm sure will be different from what you have seen so far. Okay, and also we will be doing some assessments and activities in between, okay, to make the session interesting. And I request all of you to kindly, you know, participate in these assessments so that we can make the session really interesting. So coming to the first, 1 minute, I'm just waiting for that presentation to get open. So the topic we are going to discuss is enabling technologies for green IoT. Okay, so we have a we cannot say a well-established IoT. IoT is a growing field wherein, you know, based on trial and error and based on a lot of experiments and research, day by day new things are added into IoT. Not only green IoT, even in the normal IoT also. Okay, and lot of additional things are coming up, lot of technologies are coming up, and new changes are coming up. You know, once in a week, if you just read through the materials related to IoT, you will find something new had established, okay, by researchers across the globe. So now they have started concentrating on an area called green IoT. So today we'll be seeing what are the technologies that have been enabled. This is just a baby. It is very much in a baby stage. It is just born. Okay, so I would like to bring to you some of the research details that are upcoming in the green IoT. Before that, I just want to take you through what is IoT and the concepts of it in my own style, and then we will see the enabling technologies for green IoT. So coming with the first activity, as I told you, I will be including a lot of activities to keep my participants, you know, active. And I also get a confidence when you participate in the activity that you are really listening to me. So it is a two-way benefit. One, you can also feel accomplished. And second, I can also feel happy that you are really listening to me. The first activity is I want you to go into, please open a new browser and type in www.slido.com. Okay, please type in www.slido.com. It will ask you for an event pin. Okay, it will ask you for an event pin. Please type in B890. Please type the event pin which is seen on my screen. Okay, and please type B890. I hope you're all able to do it. If you have a barcode scanner, the job is very, very easy. All you have to do is just scan the barcode that is shown on my screen. If you have a barcode scanner, just scan the barcode that is shown on my screen. Yes. So the first question, can I have a response from the participants? Are you able to go into that website?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, fantastic. Jay Devin, sir, thank you for that acknowledgement. If you're able to see the screen, now we are going to make a beautiful word cloud. Okay, with all of us put together as a joint effort, we are going to prepare a word cloud. Now, you have been attending this session for almost 1 week. Okay, and this is, I think, your sixth day or, yeah. So, what have you understood by the single word IoT? Okay, I want each one of you to put in your inputs. Let's create a beautiful cloud. Whatever comes into your mind, when you hear the word IoT or you have heard from so many speakers on all these days, okay, whatever comes in your mind, just key in only the keywords. Don't type sentence. Please put only keywords. Yes. Please start typing your keywords. Let's make a beautiful cloud. I want all of you to kindly participate. Only then we can make a beautiful cloud. Teamwork makes dream work. So if my dream of making an IoT cloud has to come true, I want all of you to do a teamwork. Very good. Cloud world, connected objects, connect everything to internet. Very good. Interconnection of things. Fantastic. Some more. There are almost 75 to 80 participants. If each of you put one keyword, we can get a beautiful cloud. I want everyone to participate. Integrated solutions, very good. Only 5 of you have participated out of 75. Dear participants, kindly give your inputs. I'm waiting. If you have any difficulty in going into the slide, please tell me, we can solve it. Hi, Google to all. Okay, you mean to say voice over control, right? Device in remote access. Okay, integrated solutions. Smart home security, very good. Smart home security, robotics, okay. Device in remote access, good, very good. Yes, it is used in medical field. Very good. The medical field and home security are completely nowadays moving into IoT world. See, the more inputs you get, the more beautiful cloud you will be making. The more inputs you get, the more agriculture IoT. Very good. Whoever have put that, fantastic. That is one more area where IoT is very commonly used nowadays. Home security, medicine, and agriculture. Very good. 3 applications have come out.
Ma'am, many are participating in the chat window as well.
Ma'am, don't put it in the chat, ma'am. Kindly put it here because we need to form a beautiful cloud and I need to hand over this to Lakshmi ma'am as my gift.
That's great, ma'am. That's great.
Yeah.
I request all the audiences to move forward based on that QR code. Thank you. The same you can copy paste there as well. Whatever you have given here, the same you can repeat it.
Yes, dear participants. I know you are, you will be really participating. Please don't put it in the chat. Please go into slido.com. Very easy. Just type in the 4-digit even PIN and start giving your answers. Connect everything to internet. Lakshmi ma'am, can I wait for another 2-3 minutes? Defense IoT, very good. A new word has been added. Defense IoT, yes, I'm starting to get. In one word, all in Google. Okay. Smart electricity, electronic appliances. Yes, I'm getting more and more. Agriculture IoT is becoming bigger. Smart electricity is a new word. Connected objects, medical IoT. Okay. Automobile, yes, automobile industry is another area where you would be using IoT. Today I will be concentrating on what are the changes you can make in medical IoT, home automation, okay, all that to bring in green IoT. Okay, blockchain for IoT, okay, smart class like this. Oh, great. Yes, IoT is a gateway to future generation. Fantastic. I think you are a good handful of participants. Okay. Let's not waste any more time. Let's move on to the content. Lakshmi ma'am, this is a beautiful cloud that was made of all these sessions put together so far. Decrease in human efforts, smart devices. Yes, the word smart, is itself becomes a synonym for IoT. Anywhere you use the word smart, okay, smart watch. Okay, smartphones, smart devices, anywhere you see smart cities, okay, smart dustbins, you see a word smart, that means IoT is related to it. Okay, yeah, so very good. Thank you all of you for all those inputs that you have given. So we will be having this one at the end also to learn what you have newly learned today, to understand what you have newly learned today. Yes, retail industry has also got IoT. I think in future there won't be any industry which do not have IoT, right? Yeah. So we are moving on to the next part of our presentation. Thank you very much, dear participants, for that active participation. And I request all of you to remain the same throughout the session. So coming into the, as you have already defined IoT in your own style or by creating that word cloud, let me also give my own definition of Internet of Things that I have understood. So Internet of Things is nothing but, as you rightly said in the word cloud, it is a network of physical objects. Okay. Why should only people talk to people? Why can't also things talk to another thing? Okay. Without the intervention of human being. So that's when IoT came into the market. Okay, so when I say network of physical objects, the physical objects can be anything. It can be a device, it can be a vehicle, it can be a electronic item that you rightly put in the word cloud, it can be a software, it can be a sensor, it can even be a human being. Okay, so only thing is the objects, all these physical objects, we collect data and exchange this data with each other. So when you say exchange data with each other, it is nothing but a communication takes place. Okay. So that is the very simple definition of IoT. Now, let me just start with a quote. How many of you know what is this actually, what is this application called as? the picture which I have put in my slide. Could you tell me what that application means? Anybody, any participants?
Sorry,
it is a smart thing. What is that thing I'm asking?
Like Alexa, man.
Oh, okay, sir. Like Alexa. Any other answers, sir? Any other answers? One answer is Alexa, yes. But it, can you tell me the specific application of it? I will give you the name if you want. The name of this product is already given in the picture. It is called Ring. R-I-N-G. It's called Ring.
Anything related to home security?
You're right. You're right. It is related to home security. It's got a very interesting story. Let me start with the story, sir. This is called Ring. Ring is nothing but a smart doorbell. Okay? It's a smart doorbell. What this doorbell will do is, you can see that it has got an attached camera. Right? So if somebody stands in front of the door and rings this bell, so this is a bell, you just press this bell, you know, it will capture your image. It will send even a real-time video to the house owner, mobile phone, okay? And the person, either he can be inside the house or he can be outside the house, okay? But then by just looking at the camera, they can understand who exactly is standing in front of the door, okay? And then they can decide whether they need to open the door or not, okay? So that is a fantastic application. Now, this is not the interesting story. Let me tell you an interesting story. I don't know how many of you watch an interesting episode in Netflix known as Shark Tank. S-H-A-R-K, Shark Tank. This is an episode where people, if you have a very interesting idea, okay, you can go into that Shark Tank forum and then you can present your idea. There will be investors sitting and listening to your idea. Once your idea is capturing the attention of those investors, they will be ready to invest in your product. And then you can make it into a saleable product. So that is a very interesting episode. So many interesting products which has not even come into market. If you want to know about it, you can watch the Shark Tank episode. Okay. So now, one of the person who made this Ring with this idea, he went and proposed his idea in the Shark Tank episode. He was listened to by four people. But all the four of them, they did not like this idea. So they said, no, it's not going to work out. So we are going to, sometimes the idea will be rejected also by the investors. So this idea was rejected. This man did not give up. He spent his own money and made this doorbell and started, you know, selling it through Amazon. Amazon, on seeing this product, they were so, you know, the kind of people attracted to this product. He thought, okay, I can buy this product on my own and then sell it as my own product. So Amazon brought the product. Now he's a many million dollars company, this Ring is. And now Ring, the owner of this Ring or the inventor of this Ring is now sitting in the Shark Tank as an investor. Okay. So this is a kind of motivation story that would say, why are we sitting through all these STTPs? Why are we learning about IoTs? Why are we learning about all this? May have a sudden click of mind wherein a new idea may emerge out, right? So that idea, if in case we have an idea, we shouldn't give it up unless it becomes successful. You may have many rejections, but then there will be one right person who will identify you, and then your idea may be taken up to the next level. The quote says by Henry Samley, we need to get smarter about hardware and software innovation in order to get the most value from the emerging IoT. Yeah, so we should not only learn about the concept as teachers, we should be also understanding, and we should make new hardware and software. Kevin Ashton was a man who made this, who coined this word Internet of Things. He's said to be the father of IoT. Okay, and he's the one who changed the entire world right now. So what is the comparison before IoT and after IoT is, before IoT also, we had devices, we had computers, we had phones, okay, we had electronic items, everything was there. But human being had to go from computer to computer, carry information from computer to computer, transfer data from computer to computer. They were all not connected. But after IoT, you can see that the changes, all these devices are existing as were existing earlier, but they are all connected right now. And you need not have an human intervention for these communications to happen. Okay, it happens automatically by means of a cloud or an internet or a network. Okay, so that is the major difference before IoT and after IoT. So whenever you say IoT, it includes three keywords. One, it helps you to interact. Second, it helps you to collaborate. And third, by sharing the experiences of interaction and collaboration, you come out with better products the next time. Okay, so that is the IoT industry world actually working. Coming into the four fundamental components of an IoT, I'm going a little fast here because thinking that you these would have been already covered for you in the previous sessions. But still, I want to do it in my own style. So fundamental components of an IoT, there are four fundamental components. The four fundamental components are, the first component is your sensors and your end devices. Okay, so this is where you get to use them. Okay, that is your sensors and your end devices. Then second is your data processors. Okay, real-time data processors, streaming processors, and so on. Third is your user interface. User interface is where the users can be in the form of an application, it can be form of a device. Okay, anything where your users get to communicate with the IoT device. And the fourth important component of all this, if all this have to work, we need to have a network connectivity. Okay, so these four are said to be the fundamental components of IoT. Coming into this just example to show you how the IoT works. So you have a sensor moat. Today I will also be telling you what is this moat. Okay, to start with, you have a bulb. Okay, this bulb is automized. Okay, so that goes into an analytics. This is a kind of data analytics to decide when to switch on the bulb and when to switch off the bulb. Okay, so it goes to the commands to the analytics comes from a cloud server. Okay, wherein you have a web socket, internet. Okay, all this is not compulsory, but optional depending on type of applications. And then you have a proxy server. This is very important. You need to have a gateway, which has a kind of authentication to be done for the IoT network. And then you have all types of sensor modes, okay, which we will be also seeing today. So sensor modes and processors, and of course radio is nothing but the communication protocols. Okay, so all this is the components of a simple IoT that, you know, helps in switching on and off a light bulb. Okay, now coming to the, this is again another example of a block diagram of an IoT. So whenever you talk about IoT, internet is very important, okay, must. And then it can be used by a remote user, it can be used by a local user. Okay, for all that, you have to have something called as a gateway to connect your remote users and local users. Okay, and then this is an example of a smart home automation. Okay, wherein you have your dryer, your washing machine, your, you know, your dishwasher and your bulb connected to a connected power socket. See, this is here, Wi-Fi. So which means this is not an ordinary power plug. This is a connected power plug, which means through a hub, it is connected to the internet. And from a remote area, you can connect, you can send messages to the internet and you can control the socket. Thereby, you can switch on and off the light. You can switch on and off the washing machine and also the dishwasher. Okay, so this is how internet actually works. So you can be a local user or you can be a remote user or you can be even operated from an application portal. So whichever it is, it has to go through the internet. Then it comes to the local gateway, which is located at your house. And from the local gateway, the signals are sent to the power socket. Okay, so that's how the internet basically works. Yes, the sensors are the most important part of your IoT device. We will be seeing more about this, types of sensors and so on. So the main job of the sensors is to measure value. Okay, it will be sending raw data. Sensors, please remember, sensors do not do any processing. Okay. Why it doesn't do any processing? Number one, it has to be very minute in size, simple, okay, lightweight, and more of all, it has to be a low power device. That is the most important need of being chosen as a sensor for IoT network. So your sensor should be a low power sensor. So if it has to be a low power sensor, it cannot afford to do any processing of data. Okay. So the job of a sensor is just to collect data or measure data and send the raw data as it is to the processor or the device that has to be processed. Okay. So that is the basic thing about sensors. Of course, we'll be seeing more about it. As I told you, there will be the important fourth important component is your connectivity. Connectivity can be by any media. The medium can be satellite, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, WAN. It can even be RFID, radio frequency. And the latest one is NFC. Can somebody say what is NFC?
Near field communication.
Fantastic, Jayadevan sir. Near field communication. So near field communication is coming up very much. Can you give me an example of near field communication application, sir?
Mobile banking.
Pardon, sir?
Mobile banking.
Mobile banking.
Okay, yes. That ATM card, NFC, ATM cards.
No, sir, ATM cards are not NFC. Have you heard of tap to pay, sir? Tapping your ATM cards to pay. That is an example of NFC.
Whenever we go for a shop, when we tap our credit card, that is, I think, NFC, because earlier it was mobile.
Fantastic, ma'am. Don't think. You are 100% right. You are 100% right. NFC is, ma'am, the only condition. The only condition for NFC is the two devices should be tapped with each other. Unlike other communication medium can have a distance between the two devices. Minimum distance, 10 meters, 100 meters, depending on what communication you're using. But for NFC, the communication should not have any distance. The two devices have to be tapped. Another best example of NFC is your Samsung Galaxy phones, which have, this wireless charging. Fantastic, Jayadevan sir. You make my sessions interesting. Wireless charging.
And Bluetooth connection.
Yes.
Bluetooth connection between the two smart devices.
Your audio is not very clear, sir. Can you please put your mic near to your mouth and speak?
Bluetooth connection between two Android phones or smart devices.
No, sir. Bluetooth connection is a different story, actually. Bluetooth itself is a different communication media. What we are talking about is NFC, near field communication. That is the latest ones, but you need to tap the two devices. Ma'am, any smartphones, if you have a OnePlus, if you have Apple, if you go down the menu, you will have Bluetooth and all that. Like that, now in the latest smartphones, you also have something called NFC. So you have your switch on your NFC, and if another phone also has NFC, just keep it, tap it at the back. The back side of the phone, you will have an NFC kind of reader here. Okay. So when you keep two phones like this, close to each other, then there will be a connection established. You can transfer data. You can transfer, whatever you want to transfer. Okay. So that is one thing very best. And it is coming up. It's a very recently coming up area. Yeah, coming to the connectivity, there are a lot of protocols needed for doing this connectivity. Some of the very commonly used protocols in IoT are constraint application protocol, which is COAP, and then you have message queuing telemetry protocol, which is MQTT protocol, and of course HTTP, all of us know, and XMPP also. These are the protocols. The most preferred protocol is MQTT. The main difference between HTTP and using MQTT in IoT is, in IoT, the constraint is the devices should respond quickly. Yes or no, sir? Can the device have a delay in response?
No, ma'am.
Actually, if we delay, then there is no use of the message.
Correct, ma'am. If you delay, there is no use in going for IoT. You can do it by yourself, right? So if you need zero delay, you should replace, most of the IoTs are replaced from HTTP to MQTT, because in HTTP, that connected devices are on and off only when you send message. Between devices, when you want to send a message, you switch on the device. When you don't want to send a message, you put the device in offline. But in MQTT, the devices are always kept open. You want to send a message, you send it. If you don't want to send also, the device is kept open. Okay, so that is a major difference between HTTP and MQTT. Okay, so that is why MQTT is the most preferred protocol in case of IoT networks and IoT applications. Okay, so this is the way in which connection happens in IoT is first you have your end devices. It can be from as small as a camera or a mobile to as big as a industry application machine, or it can be even a car. Okay, they are connected via any of these communication. And then you have a gateway. This gateway is very, very important. What this gateway does is it authenticates this end device. It checks whether this is a real end device to be connected to the network, because security is one of the major issue in IoT. Okay, and I will give you an example of a biggest threat that has happened in the IoT world. Okay, it was a research done in Israel University. If you know this, you will understand the other side of IoT and how much we as teachers will have to contribute to make to come out of these hindrances of IoT. Okay, and then you have the cloud, which can be either a private cloud or it can be a public cloud. Okay, so when this mobile has to interact with a car, it cannot do directly. It has to send a message to the gateway. Gateway will authenticate it, find out that the message is a true message, then sends it to either a private cloud or a public cloud, depending on what you have used. And then from the cloud, the message goes to the car. So this is the path in which, the communication happens between IoT devices in any network. Okay, for these messages to be sent from one device to the gateway, from gateway to the cloud, from cloud to the device, you need communication protocols. Okay, and as I said, MQTT is very much preferred over any other protocols in IoT. Coming to the data processing, this is again a very, very important area of IoT. As I said, sensors don't do any processing. Their only job is to measure data, sense data, sense any change. Just raw data is passed on to the processor. So there should be a processor to take care of all these datas. The datas have to be processed, and only then decisions have to be taken based on the result of the processing. So this is done by a special kind of a processor, which is again a very interesting area for teachers to explore more and more, is this data processors, okay, which are used in your IoT. Coming to one more latest advancement of the way in which data is stored in your IoT network. As I told you in the previous diagram, in this diagram you can see the end device, gateway, and then cloud. There is only one word called cloud. But then, as I told you, every day some new advancements happens in the IoT world. One of the latest advancement is introducing the fog computing. Let me give you a real-time example and tell you why do we need a fog computing. Say suppose I have a camera attached in front of my house. It is it's a theft detection camera, okay, which detects every movement that happens in front of the house. Okay, so any unwanted movement happens, immediately it will give an alert message to the owner of the house, alerting him that some unwanted movements are happening. Okay, so let's say it's a motion sensor is attached or camera is attached. Now, what happens? Suppose there is a wind blowing, the trees are shaking, or a dog is walking on the street. Okay, or something that is not related to theft, but something is happening. Earlier days, what happened was these cameras or these sensors, all the data that are collected then and there, either it is relevant or not relevant, as I told you, sensors don't do any processing. They just collect these data, and all these data are just dumped into cloud. Okay. Just dumped into cloud. Either it can be a private cloud or it can be a public cloud. Just dumped without any authentication, without any processing. These data were just dumped. Then later on, people thought, okay, should this really be like this? Because cloud started becoming bigger and bigger, and cloud started having more of unwanted data. Okay, therein we had big data analysis, big data processing, and all that. So that became big field. Then people thought, why can't we think in a different direction? So instead of putting everything raw data into cloud, let me stop it somewhere in the middle. And fog is nothing but, you know, the end of a cloud is called fog. Okay, the end line of a cloud is called fog. So instead of dumping everything straight away into cloud, let me stop somewhere in between. Okay, let me process the data. Let me find out if this data is really related to theft reduction or just a simple movement of a dog or a tree. Okay, and then if you think that it is a simple movement, let's not put it into cloud. Let's delete it. If you think it's a real, movement that is related to theft detection, let me post it into the cloud. You're getting it? So that is when we had this new concept known as fog computing. The other name for fog computing is, we also call it as edge computing. So edge computing is before it is actually computed, at the edge you catch hold of the data. Okay, and then you analyze the data to find out how far it is an authenticated data, and then you do send it to the main cloud. Only if you send it to the main cloud, the data passes from one device to another device. See, the cloud is only, see, this car and mobile is attached only to the cloud. So if the data is in the cloud, it cannot go to the next cloud. Unless and otherwise, you push the data into the main cloud. Are you getting it? So only when you authenticate and push the data into main cloud, this will pass on to the local fog. And then from the fog, the data moves on to the devices that are connected to the respective fogs. Okay, so this is again a very interesting concept known as fog computing or otherwise edge computing. Now, why am I talking about all this? Am I telling all this to while away the time? No. All this has an impact on green IoT. So when I talk about green IoT, I will be telling about cloud computing, fog computing, how it helps, how it has to be changed in order to bring in a green IoT world. Okay, yes. The next important, as I told you, is a user interface. So this is where you communicate with your IoT device. Okay, so it can be detecting the temperature of a refrigerator. So once your refrigerator temperature is sensed, you should be knowing. How do you know it? You get a message in your applications or you get a message in your mobile phone telling that, okay, this is the temperature. So you have to, you know, switch on and off your refrigerator, so on and so forth. Even in the doorbell example that we started with Ring, the image taken by the camera is sent to your mobile. So your mobile should have an application called Ring, which will be showing you who is standing in front of the camera. That is nothing but the user interface. Okay. All this put together has made our world a better, better place, isn't it? That is, cannot be denied. So IoT has made our world very peaceful, and you know, it has connected things, it has made our life easy, so we get more time, you know, to enjoy life. Now coming to the IoT architecture, let me just take you through a little deeper into the IoT architecture. So coming into IoT architecture and how it works, I have taken the components, basic elements of IoT architecture with, you know, a more detailed kind of thing. So we saw all this earlier, but still, you know, I'm just connecting it, everything together. So let me start with the most important, I told you, is the sensors and the end devices. Okay, well, you might have heard of two words. One is sensors and other is actuators. So I'll be telling you what is the difference between a sensors and an actuator, right? So this is the first starting point of an IoT. It goes through a local gateway. This is the gateway that may be in your house. It may be in a hospital in case of medical IoT. Okay, it can be in a hub in case of smart traffic or smart cities, in a control room. So that is called local gateway. From the local gateway, the data that is captured by the sensors moves on to the cloud gateway. So this is the major cloud gateway wherein you have the cloud data. Okay, and this cloud data, you know, this may be processed depending on various algorithms and various models. Okay, machine learning algorithms are used and machine learning models are used. Okay, and all this is processed and you have various other components. So we'll see one by one what it is. So the first one is your things. First thing, when you say Internet of Things, things is playing the major role. So what is this things? I'm just going very quickly. Things are nothing but it's an object which is equipped with either sensors and, you know, these sensors transfer the data through a network and actuators are attached to it in order to connect the data, right, in order to activate the operations that are meant to be done. For example, you have a, you know, the, what to say, the smart irrigation nowadays, very commonly used everywhere in the field of agriculture. So when you have the smart irrigation, you can see that, you know, the sensors sense the temperature of the soil, and then it sends the data to the, you know, the processor. Processor finds out, compares it with the, what to say, the benchmark data, and then finds out, okay, if it is below the data or above the data, accordingly it switches on and off the irrigation. So here the sensor senses the data, but the switch on and off the pump, water pump, is done by an actuator. Okay, so that is the difference between a sensor and an actuator. Coming to the next one is a gateway. I told you the gateway can be a local gateway. It can also be a cloud gateway. Okay, so all this is connected by means of internet as the major connectivity modem. And gateways are used. Any IoT applications, they have to cross through a gateway before they enter into the main cloud. Okay, so data goes from things to the cloud and vice versa through these gateways. Okay? And filtering is done, data processing and filtering before moving it to the cloud. Okay, why this is done is mainly to reduce the volume of data. Okay, you cannot put unwanted data there. So a filtering is done. And based on this only, the commands are given to the actuators. Okay, once the control commands from the cloud also comes back to the things. Sensing data goes to the cloud. From the cloud, you get some control commands. Both these are transferred through the gateway. Okay. Then coming to the, yeah, we already saw the difference between this. One is a cloud gateway, other is a fog gateway. The cloud gateway is the main gateway which connects between fogs. Okay, and fog gateway is a local kind of a gateway that connects only a few devices to it. Okay, so fog is a place where the main communication, you know, happens, and then from the fog it is transferred to the cloud. Next is your streaming data processor. Why the word streaming here is used? Can somebody please help me? Why the word streaming?
Ma'am, streaming in the sense like whenever data is coming continuously and even processing is happening runtime only, that time only. So that we call it streaming.
Very good, ma'am. Real-time data processing, right, ma'am? Any data processing that happens on a real-time data, we call it a streaming, right, ma'am? So streaming data is a real-time data and continuous data. Very good. So examples of streaming, I think most of the IoTs, yeah, fantastic, ma'am. Most of the IoTs that we use come under the category of streaming, right? Smart patient care, monitoring of production line, supply chain optimization, intrusion, surveillance, fraud detection. All these applications that are related to IoT, sports analytics is very, very important example of streaming. Okay, where you have real-time analytics, when a bowler just throws the ball, you know, immediately you get all kind of data. What is the speed in which he has thrown, where it has pitched, okay, everything else. The context aware promotions and advertisements.
Well, I have one very live example. As you are doing online portal, this is also a part of streaming only.
Very good, ma'am. Fantastic. You're right. Yeah. Yeah. So traffic monitoring. Yes. Nowadays, even billboards, even the boards that you put on the street, okay, which carries advertisements, are not the flex. We have moved on to online billboard data advertisements, right? So everywhere streaming has captured its area. The next important thing is you will have a data lake. Now, there are two types of thing. One is a data lake. Data lake is where data is just simply stored. Okay, the name itself says data lake. Okay, so it is like storing the data generated by all your connected device, everything, without any formatting. No formatting is done, no processing is done, nothing is done, no analysis of data is done, nothing. Just take the data from different places, put it in one place. Okay. And that is called data lake. So the data will be in the natural format. Okay. And any machine learning algorithm you want to apply, you have to apply on the data lake. Pardon? Ma'am?
Data lake and data pool is same, ma'am. Ma'am, I just want to know. I don't know exactly. Data pool and data lake is same.
Yes, yes. Data lake and data pool are the same. They are just two different names referred to. Yeah. But then there is one more word called data warehouse, which is not the same. Okay, ma'am? Data lake and data
pool. Is different because same.
Yes. Data lake and data pool are same. But you also have one more word called data warehouse, which is used in IoT devices. This, when you talk about data warehouse, you can see the difference in this picture. Here, the data is in the natural format, randomly stored. But whereas in the warehouse, your data is neatly formatted, organized, structured, cleaned data, unwanted things are removed. Okay, and then only the wanted clean data in a neat format. Okay, is stored into data warehouse. So these are two different things. One is data lake or data pool. Another is data warehouse. Okay. The next thing is, the difference between data warehouse and data lake is, this is a data lake. You can see just the diagram will tell everything. Here you can see it's a mix of data, different sizes of data, different colors, okay, different types of data just put together in one place. That's it. But here when you see, all data are of the same size. Okay, and all are neatly arranged and neatly kept in a proper scheme. Okay, and cleaned and then so that when you want to do an analysis, this data will be easy for you to carry out an analysis rather than this data. Okay, so this transformation also happens in the IoT. And coming to the next one, now your data is clean, structured, and then stored in the data warehouse. Now the next job is you need to take this data and do a data analytics. Okay, so data analytics is taken from the data warehouse, not from the data pool or data lake. Okay, and then you generate a kind of diagrams, infographics, visualizations and all that. And then based on that, you send commands to the devices to be controlled. Okay, yeah. Next is coming to the four types of analytics. We have descriptive, predictive, diagnostic and prescriptive analysis. So the descriptive analysis tells you what happened in the past. Okay, for example, this coronavirus of the seven to 6 months of lockdown. What has happened to the theater industry? You want to do a small analysis and find out, okay, what was the loss? Who are the people who are affected? What had happened to them? What are the alternative jobs that they're doing right now? What is the solution? Okay, if you want to do a descriptive analysis, you can do it. That is the data. That happened in the, it's already passed. Okay, we have been locked down for 5 months. You want to take that data and then analyze it. Predictive analysis is predicting the future. Now, suppose a patient has, sugar, so much of, heart problem, and then he has got pressure variations, and he has got illness like, asthma or something like that. What is his probability of getting coronavirus? Okay, so if I can do a kind of models like this and say, if a person is this age, has these diseases, the probability of him recovering from coronavirus is this much. A person of this age with these diseases, recovering stage is this much. So if I'm able to predict the future, okay, and then come out with a model and then apply it for any data set and then, derive that model, then it's going to be predictive analytics. Coming to diagnostic analytics is like, it helps you to understand what something happened in the past. This can also be something very similar to descriptive analytics, but descriptive analytics only gives you the, the kind of images, pictures, infographics and so on. Diagnostic analytics gives you more in-depth data and then results. Prescriptive analytics is something that, a recommended action. Something has happened. What should I do? What should be my action? Okay, what should be my thing to it? So that is how you understand. Coming to machine learning models, we have various machine learning models. So we can create more precise based on the data warehouse data and based on the four types of analytics, we come out with a model. Okay, model in the sense, it's a general model. Any data applied to it, it will be able to give you a result. Okay, so that is a kind of machine learning models. So you help these machines to input these data into these machines. Okay, and then this machine is actually designed by human, and this machine will act according to the input data that is given to it. Okay, ma'am. And that is okay, ma'am. That is about machine learning models. And coming to control applications, yes. So here is where your applications are actually controlled. For example, you have a smart window, okay, at home, wherein your window is automatically closed and opened depending on the weather conditions, okay, or even a forecast. You forecast the weather and then prior you close the window. Suppose you are not at home. Okay, they are all very interesting examples. Another example I told you is watering irrigation system. Okay, so the control applications are those applications that control a kind of device. Control means switch on and off, close, open, okay, push forward, backward. So move, something like that, move left, move right. So anything that controls an application are called as control applications. So how is this sensor to actuator flow actually happens? Is we will take an example of a temperature sensor that detects heat. Okay, it may be sent in Fahrenheit. This detect signal goes to a control center. From the control center, the command is sent to this is the example of your automatic sprinkler. Command is sent to your sprinkler, and then this command only switches on and off your sprinkler. Okay, so this is how a sensor communicates with an actuator. Okay, for in between, you need a control center to do all this. The next and the very important is your user applications. The user applications is what you see, okay, and use actually. Yeah, apart from this, the other areas where we have a lot of probability of working in IoT is device management. We all are thinking of only designing hardwares, okay, making projects using Arduino board and Raspberry Pi and whatnot, okay, and think that only is IoT. But IoT has got a different other avenues also, and that is about device management. IoT is all about connected devices, isn't it? So if you have to have the devices connected with each other, you should be managing these devices. As I told you, device identification is very, very important. An unwanted device cannot be attached to your IoT network. It means hack your data, okay? And configuration and control of these devices, okay, is important. Monitoring and diagnostics of these devices also is equally important. And then, you get to know what is the security and maintenance of these data. Devices, you have to fix the bugs, okay, address all the security vulnerabilities and so on and so forth. Let me give you a case study that was done by a university in Israel. Can you tell me which company has come out with the first smart bulb?
Philips.
Pardon, ma'am? Jaydevan sir?
Philips,
yes, you're right. Philips Hue is the first smart bulb. So what this Israel university people did was they took a Philips bulb, okay, and they took a IoT network that was already existing. This was done as a lab experiment. Thank God it was not a real-time hacking. It was done as a prototype of the hacking. So they took a Philips Hue bulb, and they intruded into a IoT home security network. And in that home security network, a laptop was connected, a desktop was connected, his mobile PC and washing machine and all that was connected. And what he did was just by, switch, there was already a bulb connected in the smart home network. He just removed that bulb, this university people, it was a team of people. They removed the bulb and replaced it with their own Philips bulb. Okay, so by which they easily entered into the IoT network. So, but the IoT network, they did not identify because they thought there was a bulb, there was a machine, washing machine, there was a laptop, there was a desktop. So they thought, okay, that is their own network. But then, the bulb that was there in that network was a bulb inserted by a hacker. Now, what they did was, all the data that were, they were connected to a common gateway, and these data were transmitted from one device to another device easily. So using this bulb, they were able to hack the information from the laptop. Even personal information were hacked from the laptop, and they even showed it live on a television that, by using a simple bulb, they just broke open all data that are pertaining to that particular house or home. What happens, imagine if this is done to our military or if it is done to our hospitals to, you know, to steal data of patients. Okay, it's going to be biggest vulnerability that could ever happen, right? Stealing of data in IoT network. The device management is another very, very important area, and I'm also doing a research in this area. There was once a vice president of UK who had a pacemaker attached in his heart. Okay, and this pacemaker was an IoT device. It was connected to a doctor's system. And the doctor could monitor and predict even before anything happens to him. The doctor will be able to predict any malfunction of this pacemaker and then correct it then and there immediately. So that was advantage, positive side of it. But it also had a negative side. This happened. All this is not the story that I'm telling. They are all real case studies that I'm sharing with you. So they really hacked the pacemaker and they even tried to stop the pacemaker from working. But they were not successful by the grace of God. But then imagine if they had been successful, they would have even killed a person virtually. Okay. So in future, if we are planning to have all devices in our body with IoT, so what is very, very important is device management. And the next important is user management. And third is security monitoring. So these three play a very, very vital role. We only start up thinking of building sensors, building processors, making new connections, new applications, and so on and so forth. That is all the one side of IoT. But IoT also has a dark side. And the dark side is you have to also concentrate on the device management, user management, and security issues of the IoT. So it is important when you go for a user management, it is like you have to identify who are all going to be the users of the IoT. What are their roles? Not all users can do all things. So they should be assigned roles and the roles should be given different levels and ownership. Okay, this is about user management. Coming to security, this is what I was telling you. So cyber criminals can access to the brain of the whole IoT and take a complete control of it without your knowledge. You may be thinking that, you know, my life is so sophisticated and then because of IoT and you'll be enjoying the use of IoT. But who knows, there will be a darker side where hackers are able to access your information. Okay, so that is about the three important areas that you should concentrate. Yes, so this is a case study of intelligent light system using all that we saw in the previous sessions. So you have your daylight, sound, and people movement captured. Okay, so this is a smart home where you have your security alert system installed in the smart home. So your security alert system captures the light, luminosity of your light, daylight, the sounds, that happens, movements, okay? All that is detected by the sensors. Raw data is sent to the data lake. This data lake extracts the data, okay, puts it in a neat form and then creates a data warehouse. So this data warehouse is then goes for data analytics. 3 days back, what happened? 2 days back, what happened? In future, what would happen? So all these kind of data analytics can be done. And then same data is applied to some models, machine learning models, and then based on the control signals. Sir, could you please kindly switch off? Can you please kindly thank you, Lakshmi. So you're based on the machine learning algorithms and the models, your control signals are generated. Those signals are moved on to the actuators. You can also give manual signals by your user application or your mobile application and then switch on and off the lamp, the whatever you want to control in your house. Okay. So this is a very simple application wherein I put all the components together. So here you saw where is data lake, where is data warehouse, where is data analytics used, where is business model, your machine learning model used. Okay, all that put together in one application is your intelligent lighting system. Yeah. So I'm just going very fast with this IoT architecture. So coming into IoT hardware platform, I think already you would have discussed more about this. So I'm just skipping through. One is Arduino. Let me just tell you one difference between if I ask you to name two processors used in IoT, which are the two commonly used processors? Can I have the name from the participants? Yes, two very commonly used processors in Arduino.
Yeah, audio muted, they can use the chat window. Because they are unconsciously unmuting them.
Thank you, Lakshman. Thank you for that information. I'm just looking at your, yeah. We've gone, okay, Arduino and Raspberry Pi, very good. And now I just want you to please give an answer. I think commonly the names used by teachers, especially when you want to do a small project, okay, in a lab, or you want to teach what is IoT to students, the basic two things that we use, one is Arduino and the other is Raspberry Pi. Can you please? Raspberry Pi. Yeah, ARM, Atmega and all that are advanced, a little kind of advanced. Beginners use Arduino and Raspberry Pi, right, sir? So what is the major difference between this Arduino and Raspberry Pi? Okay. Raspberry Pi has processing. Arduino. Very good. You are very good participants. I really enjoyed the session. Arduino is a controller. Raspberry Pi is a processor. That's a right answer. That's a 100% right answer. Arduino is a microcontroller. Raspberry Pi is a microprocessor. So in Arduino, you can only control devices. For example, switch on and off a motor, open and close a door or a window. Okay, move a particular device. Okay, move forward, backward. All this controlling operations can be done by using Arduino. But when you want to process data, it can be audio data, it can be video data, it can be ordinary data. When you want to process data, you cannot use Arduino. You will have to go for Raspberry Pi. The Raspberry Pi is very rightly said, it's a mini computer by Avinash. Very good. It's a mini computer wherein you have everything inbuilt into it. And it requires dash. Raspberry Pi requires dash. Can you fill the dash? Lakshmi ma'am, I think you can unmute them. They badly want to talk. On my behalf, I request you, ma'am. I think they can.
Yeah, I do that. I did it. They can proceed with it. Because
I assure you, they won't disturb you, ma'am, on behalf
nice.
Of us.
Yeah, if that happens, that would be happy for every one of us.
Yeah, participants, on behalf of you, I would please see to that you unmute immediately.
Hello, ma'am, you're taking
the Raspberry Pi memory.
Arduino is a company, and Arduino Uno is a processing controller. Means like, it's a processing controller, and right. Arduino is a company. And about Raspberry Pi is a small full-fledged computer. And yesterday only in the session, I got a good, they have given such a nice presentation. So I learned from this HTTP only, ma'am. That's what I want to know.
Very good. Arduino is, ma'am, the name Arduino is from a company, even Raspberry Pi, that leave it. The basic thing done by an Arduino is a controller. Raspberry Pi is a processor. And Raspberry Pi, as Jaidevan sir rightly said, it requires an operating system. Arduino do not have an operating system, does not require an operating system to work. But Raspberry Pi needs an operating system, which is freely downloadable. Okay, and you can just take it in a USB and put it in your chip and then start functioning it. Okay, so that is the beauty of Arduino and Raspberry Pi, the two commonly used, the ones that are very commonly used. Okay. And both are, Arduino is an open source. That is the best thing about Arduino. It's got a very small memory and all that. Okay, I'm not going very deep into it. Arduino needs a shield. Can you tell me what is a shield, ma'am? Shield.
You can enhance the hardware support using this.
Pardon, sir?
You can enhance the hardware support.
Okay, no, I'm asking the question, what is meant by a Wi-Fi shield, sir? Can you see?
Wi-Fi shield, using that we can... interface with Wi-Fi Arduino.
Yes. Doesn't have an automatic interface. Your ordinary Arduino, this green color is Arduino board. the one you see on the top, blue color, I have placed one on top of another, like a sandwich. Okay, the blue color that you see on the top is called the Wi-Fi shield. I think you can see the name here. So only when the shield is placed on the Arduino, your Arduino will have a connectivity. Otherwise, your Arduino cannot be connected between devices. But that doesn't happen in Raspberry Pi. Raspberry Pi has got an inbuilt connectivity. Okay, so there are some major differences between Arduino and Raspberry Pi.
Shield means like it is going to connect with many other devices or like only particular systems?
No, sir. Once you have a shield, you can connect any device. There is no particular device and all that. But when you want connectivity to happen through your Arduino, you should have it. It is not inbuilt in your Arduino. Have you got it, sir, what I'm saying?
Yes, ma'am.
But in case of Raspberry Pi, you need not have a shield and all that. It is inbuilt in your Raspberry Pi itself. It's where connectivity happens automatically.
Ma'am, this shield behave like an interface between a board? It's a genuine question. Whether it is going to be work as an interface in between Raspberry Pi and the way wherever we are going to use, or what exactly the role of the shield?
Ma'am, have your Arduino board, right? Your Arduino board is like a microcontroller, which will be processing the data. But when it is not enough, you process the data. The process data should be sent as a control command to another device to control another device or to control another microcontroller. Isn't it, ma'am? You should be sending messages or sending commands, isn't it? For sending that, you need a communication modem. You need to send through Wi-Fi or you need to send through Bluetooth or you need to send through some means of communication protocol. That will not happen automatically in Arduino. If that has to happen, you have to have an extra shield. And that is just an attachment. You keep it on top of Arduino board. Then automatically you can send messages from Arduino to any device. Are you getting it, ma'am?
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, I got it. Actually, it is same as a modem which is using internet, isn't it?
A kind of, you can do a comparison, yes. Just understand, ma'am, Arduino doesn't come with inbuilt communication protocol. You have to have an attachment. That is your shield.
Hello.
Yes, Gajendran, sir.
Ma'am, this is Gajendra Singh Mori. Actually, I have one question.
Yes, sir.
This is Ethernet shield, na? This is?
Audio is not clear, sir. Gajendran, sir.
Hello, ma'am. Hello.
Yes, sir. It is clear now. You can proceed with, sir.
My question is, this is called Ethernet shield.
Is it Ethernet field? He is asking.
Ma'am, the one that you see here is a Wi-Fi shield, but you also have an Ethernet shield.
Okay, means with this we can connect Wi-Fi.
Very good, sir. You have exactly caught the point. Fantastic.
Means, is it the Ethernet shield or a Wi-Fi shield?
This is what you see is a Wi-Fi shield, sir.
Wi-Fi shield.
Yes.
Okay, and I can get all the functionality same like ESP8266 Node MCU.
I cannot say all that can be gotten in Arduino. Arduino is a very basic thing which is only used for learning purpose, sir. Arduino cannot be used for very big applications. Arduino is not suitable because you only have 16 input-output pins and so on. So there is some restriction. But then for learning purpose, for doing it in a laboratory, for teaching your students, this is the best option, sir.
Okay, I got it. Thank you.
And one interesting thing about Arduino is it also has a very interesting version called LilyPad. Okay, LilyPad Arduino. This LilyPad Arduino can be stitched on your clothes. Okay, it can be very, very small, like a button size. It can be stitched on your clothes. Okay, and then this will act as a processor. So this can be used for, smart monitoring of your students, of your children going to school. You can stitch it in your ID cards. You can put it in your school bags or something like that. So very, very small. Okay, it's got just 9 output pins and then some connectivity and 4 input pins and reset button, positive, negative. This is just, I wanted to tell you that there is also an Arduino board which is as small as a button. Okay, this and it is washable. That is the best thing about LilyPad Adreno. You can even wash it. No harm happens to this processor that is there in the LilyPad Adreno. Okay, so Adreno has got a very wide range of applications. And next we were talking about Raspberry Pi. Raspberry Pi is of course a fully fledged computer. And why they made this Raspberry Pi again, so always it is interesting to know the history of why this was made actually. In a country like Hong Kong, they wanted to give computers to every student in the school. Okay, those countries, education is free. So they wanted to give computers to every student, but they could not afford to give a full-fledged computer. So what they did was they made a small, chip called as Raspberry Pi, which had almost all the features of a computer, and they handed it over to the students, and they did a lot of projects using that, and that's how Raspberry Pi actually came into existence. Okay, and Raspberry Pi is a closed source hardware. It needs OS to work. Okay, operating system is needed, but it is free. Your operating system is free and you can just download and then start using it. It's a good fit actually. Another interesting one is your particle I/O. This particle I/O is very, very small in size. Let me just show you a comparison of your Arduino and your particle I/O size. Okay, so it's very small in size. So when you want to go for a very handy applications, you can use this particle I/O. Okay, and this is again an interesting option. So this is particle I/O is probably it has automatic communication. Okay, enabled to communicate. It does not require a shield like that of Arduino. Without a shield itself, you can use particle I/O to communicate using Wi-Fi, cellular, or mesh network, which is inbuilt. Okay, options are there on the onboard. On the board, you can choose. Okay, though it is small, it has got better features than Arduino. Okay, then coming to the next one is Intel Edison. How can we have a processor?
Ma'am, just one question. Actually, this particle I/O come inside this Arduino or it's a separate, like it's a Raspberry?
Separate, ma'am. It's a separate.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
It doesn't come under the types of Arduino.
Uh-huh, okay.
Is that your question, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So it is not a type of Arduino. It is a separate processor, which has got an inbuilt Wi-Fi, cellular. You can choose what type of communication you want. But the major advantage of particle is it is very, very tiny. I wouldn't even say small. I would rather use the word tiny. That is the exact word. That's why it's named as particle. Okay, the name.
Ma'am, it's a processor. Again, it's a processor. It's not controller.
It's a controller, sorry.
It's a controller, no?
It's a controller.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Next is your Intel Edison. How can you have a processor world without Intel being a part of it, right? Intels are the main people of it. So they also have made a processor for IoT. It's called Intel Edison. But this Intel Edison has got a special thing. You can go for any type of connectivity. You can see Bluetooth is there, Wi-Fi is there, internet, LAN cable connection you can do. You can connect USB, you can connect your ports, all that. Okay, of course, it's a full-fledged, the streaming processor. But then it is meant for, Intel have made these processors meant for industry applications. Okay, not for domestic applications and not for, the home automations and things like that. Why specially it is made for industry applications is, industries, you have, rugged environment. Your environment may have extreme temperatures, maybe exposed to chemicals, maybe exposed to extreme pressure, okay, all that. So this processing unit is made especially to handle such rugged environment. So it is best suited for, industry application. So mostly industrial IoT applications, they start using this Intel Edison. That is why we are not very commonly seeing the word Intel Edison in the education area, because we don't mostly go for Intel Edison, because this is meant for rugged demands, okay, of the industry application. And Node MCU, I think you know it. Node MCU is again open source. It's a controller, okay, it's low cost, very simple and all that. The best advantage of this Node MCU is NodeMCU is most preferred for green IoT. The major reason of your NodeMCU is the operating voltage of this NodeMCU is very, very less. Others, you need to have minimum 5 volt, but this NodeMCU works only at a voltage of 3 volt to 3.6 volt. So here, because of the less voltage that it makes use of, you can say it is energy efficient. Okay, so most of the green IoT applications, they prefer to use NodeMCU. See, each one, I'm comparing it with another so that you know for which application, which processor or controller you can choose. Okay, and of course, it has got a different size of memory, storage capacity, and all that is differing. But then one of the best applications can be used for green IoT because its operating voltage is only between 3 to 4. Okay, and next is a BeagleBone. I saw somebody have even put in the chat. Your BeagleBone is again a very, it's a based on ARM. Okay, ARM is a very, very interesting processor. You know that, right? It's a best example of. Can somebody answer me this question? When I say ARM, is it made of RISC or CISC?
RISC, ma'am.
Pardon, sir. Jaydevan, sir.
RISC, ma'am.
Yes. The ARM full form itself means Advanced RISC Machine, right? See, RISC, the instructions based on ARM are RISC. They're very interesting. ARM has got, you know, all the applications that you see in and around you are made up of ARM processors. Your mobile phones, your, especially Apple iPhones, they use ARM only for their processors. Okay, ARM doesn't sell any processor in its name. So that is the reason you don't find any processor in the name ARM. But then, you know, it sells to somebody and they give their name and then they expose it to the market. But then all these latest processors that are available are based on ARM. ARM has got very interesting features. I have also made a YouTube channel which is called Learn with Professor Evelyn Brinda, where I have explained about these ARM with its applications in a mobile phone, how ARM is used and so on. If you are interested, you can just go through that YouTube channel to get more clarity. Yeah, and BeagleBone is made of ARM, and I can say it is one of the advanced kind of processor that you can use. Okay, it is made by Texas, so there itself everything is covered. Okay, and it's got a RAM capacity of 512 MB with Linux kernel. Okay, and you can run any code like Python, Perl, C, C++, Ruby, and so on. Okay, and you have very interesting things can be done with your BeagleBone. Okay, BeagleBone is one of the advanced. So this is just a comparison which we already saw. Right, I'm skipping this. Yes. So coming to sensors, more about sensors. Yeah, we saw already what is a sensor. I'm just skipping this. You also use a word called transducers, right? So transducers is nothing but it converts energy of one kind into another. For example, a sound energy comes from a microphone. It is converted into electrical signals for an amplifier to amplify. And then it is converted into, you know, a voice heard through the loudspeaker. Then these electrical signals are converted back into sound waves. So this is an example of a transducer, right? We also use transducers in our IoT depending on the application. The word transducer is a collective term used for both sensors, you know, as well as actuators. When I say transducer, it will have both sensors and actuators in a collective form. Okay, so that is the difference between these terminologies. And when you go into class of sensors, basically, based on the output, you can have two types of sensors. One is analog and digital. And based on the data type, you have two types of sensors. One is scalar and, sorry, that's a spelling mistake, vector sensors. Coming into the analog sensors will have continuous output signal, okay, and or voltage. For example, is temperature, speed, pressure, displacement, strain, and so on, okay, and there are many applications. I'm not going deep into it. I'm just rushing fast so that I need to complete. Digital sensors also produce some discrete values, okay, which may be in a single bit, or it can be even a group of bits called as byte, okay. And if it is single bit, it is on and off switches, okay, multiple devices, and so on and so forth. So based on that, we call it as digital sensors. Coming to the scalar sensors, we also have the third category called scalar sensors. You know, scalar sensors, they they produce the output signals, which is generally in a scalar value. Okay, I think the content is not matching with the heading. Yeah. And coming to vector sensors, they produce an output signal which is generally has both magnitude and direction. If there is no direction, only magnitude, then it is scalar. If it has got both magnitude as well as direction, it is a vector quantity, right? So like sound, image, velocity, acceleration, etc. are all vector quantities because they also have magnitude as well as direction. Okay. Coming to the type of sensors, yeah, these are the general types of sensors that are very commonly used in IoT. You have light sensors, you have temperature sensors, you have force sensors, position sensors, which are called proximity sensors. You have speed sensors, sound and chemical sensors. Okay, these are all the different types of sensors and how they function. Okay, sound sensors based on piezoelectric crystals. Then this works based on Doppler effect, optocoupler, pressure switches, thermistors, photodiodes are used. Photodiode is a diode which functions only when a light falls on it. It's a normal diode. Because of you, the whole people will be muted. Please help us. Doppler effect, then you have piezoelectric, gaseous chemical sensors, liquid chemical sensors, and so on and so forth. These are sensors that are used in industry applications, chemical sensors. Okay, not in most of the home applications. These are some of the features of the sensors that you see around IoT. Very interesting one. Where, you know, very, very small, especially it's added with the scale to tell you, you know, how small it is. Okay, and then motion sensors, okay, tilt sensors, you know, to find out the position and all these, ultrasonic, to find out the distance and all that. Then you have something called the actuators. Actuators is gives control, okay, it helps in switching on and off, gives control signals, okay, and then source of energy and so on and so forth. So actuators are the main things. And there are also different types of actuators. So actuator, you know, it can be, the sensor can be an sensor, whatever. Okay, it will all give control signals. And the control signals will go to the actuator. Actuator will decide what to be done based on these signals that are received from the sensors. Coming to the types of actuators, you have mechanical, thermal, which is magnetic also at the time, otherwise electrical, pneumatic and hydraulic. Okay, so hydraulic, you know, it consists of fluid, wherein you have a cylinder or a fluid motor. Okay, depending on the applications, you can choose what type of actuators you want to use. Okay, so this is like a kind of push and pull where you have your hydraulic sensors being used. So, you know, you can compress them. No, nearly impossible. No, compression is not possible, right, in case of liquids as that of, gases. So they can, you know, they can have a considerable kind of a force. Okay, and then that can be used for, but not all usages. It has a restricted usage. Coming to pneumatic, it is by vacuum, okay, or compressed air, which is put at a very, very high pressure. Okay, and this pneumatic is used in many applications. They quickly respond to start and stop signals. Okay, when you want to switch on and off and all that, they are quick. Okay, the better examples, you have pneumatic brakes. Okay, even if you have a small change, you can apply the brake. So this is mainly responsible for converting pressure into a force. Okay, a pressure is converted into a force. These are some of the examples of pneumatic actuators. This is a manual pneumatic actuator, and this is a air pump, okay, which acts as a actuator. Coming to electric actuators, this is very commonly used ones, and generally it is powered by a motor that converts electrical energy into a mechanical torque. Torque means some work done, okay, and electrical energy it actuates the equipments. Okay, such as a valve and all that, and it is considered to be one of the cheapest, cleanest. Why cleanest is because it's got less of mechanical parts. its electrical paths are always set to be clean. And of course, it is very fast in responding. Coming to next is thermal or magnetic actuators. So these are the actuators that are lightweight, compact, economical, and then it is based on thermal energy or magnetic energy around it. Next is a very interesting, next to this is interesting. Actually, this is a mechanical actuator. Mechanical actuator is actually used in majorly only in industry applications where you have your automatic line production, detecting the quality of a product and all that. Wherever you have a rack and pinion, it is a kind of mechanical actuators that are being used. Pulleys, gears, reins, chains. Okay, so you have a lot of oil spill. That is one of the major disadvantages of mechanical actuators. They are not clean actually. But still, in some places, we have no other options other than to use this mechanical actuator. So we go for that. Now, one thing that is very much coming up in the near field is your soft actuators. Soft IoT in agriculture for plucking, fruits from the tree or for, checking whether a fruit has ripened or not, or something like that. So such applications where you need some soft handling. That is why in the name itself, they're called as soft actuators. They're actually made up of polymers. Okay, they are based on polymer, they are designed. And they are meant to handle some fragile, soft objects. Especially used in fruit harvesting. You can see the diagram also I have given. It picks an apple. Okay, and that is an example of how a soft actuator will look like. And especially in case of medicines, you have to deal with your internal organs and so on. So you need some soft actuators which are made of flexible polymers. And they are also used in robotics, of course. Okay, and very minute changes can be done to these actuators. They don't have a random movement, but then they can have a very molecular level movement can be, because imagine picking a fruit, you cannot go fast and then in a rash movement you cannot pick the fruit. You should be having a micro level movement, and made of polymer. Next interesting is your shaped memory polymer. This is again latest ones. Now, these are the ones that are preferred in green IoT, shape memory polymers and so on. So, they are actually made very similar to a kind of shape. Okay, these are actuators that are made exactly to suit a shape. For example, you want to make an actuator that is in the shape of your hand. You want to make an actuator that is in the shape of a flower bud, or a flower or a handle, something like that. You make an actuator in that shape using polymers. Okay, and then you use that. Instead of your hand, you use that as the actuator. Okay, say for example, the diagram that I've shown here is opening a nut. Okay, it's unscrewing a nut. But for unscrewing a nut, a nice shape polymer is used. And then you just unscrew the nut and then remove the nut. Okay, these are all coming up ones. Okay, and they are biocompatibility and biodegradable. These are some of the actuators that are preferred in green IoT because these are made of biodegradable materials. These actuators are not mechanical made of mechanical parts or electrical parts which cannot be decomposed easily, but they are biodegradable. Okay, so these are the preferred ones for green IoT. Coming to light activated polymers, yes, these are some polymers that are activated by a stimulus of light, right? And they have very instant response, and they can be remotely controlled, using a variation of light frequency or changing the intensity of light. So you can see the internal reaction that happens. This is how the different monomer, oligomer and all that is placed here. And when it is exposed to UV light, immediately there is a kind of, they are activated. All these polymers are activated and they go for a kind of connectivity and they are stimulized by these UV lights. Okay. So we also have such actuators. So don't think if you say actuators, it only means motors, electrical devices, switches, on off or only actuators. That's why I brought in all these minute type of actuators also to tell you that there are also different types of actuators available, okay, which are more recently now being used in latest IoT application. And yeah, this is something I just wanted to add here. So gateway, I mean, we have already seen, so I'm skipping here. Coming to wireless sensor network, that is again a very interesting area. So there are three most used modes. They are called as modes, M-O-T-E-S. So coming to modes, there are three types of modes that are very commonly used in all the IoT network. One is MiCA2, MiCA-Z and Telos-B. Telos-B is very, very commonly used. I will tell you the comparison, then you will understand. This is the Telos-B front and back part of Telos-B. Telos-B is also called as T-mode, okay, which is very commonly used for wireless sensor network. What is this WSN all about? Wireless sensor network. Why do you need a wireless sensor network? The sensors will collect data kept within the sensor. So once the sensor collects the sensor data will have to be transmitted from the sensor to either a processor or to a cloud or to a fog or whatever. So that transmission to happen, you need a sensor network. Okay, for that transmission to happen, you need a sensor network. This network has nothing to do with your normal internet network or Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. That cannot be used in your sensors. Reason is, all those are not energy efficient. You cannot use a Wi-Fi to transmit a sensor data. You cannot use a Bluetooth to transmit a sensor data. Sensor data has to be transmitted in its own way, in a very, very low energy efficient way, because sensors will have the myth. I told you the best thing about sensors is it should be energy efficient. Okay. So it uses radio frequency. Radio frequency is the mode that is used by wireless sensor networks to transmit the sensed data. I hope I'm clear. So you can see this is the Telos-B wireless sensor network. This will be there in most of the sensors. So here you can see a chip here. This is nothing but your radio. Can you see there is a radio here? So this also has an antenna attached. Can you see there is an antenna attached here? So through this antenna, the signals are transmitted and received, okay, from the sensor to the processor or network or whatever. Okay, so this is the back portion and the front portion of Telos-B. So Telos-B has got a controller to do all these data, just transmitting the data. No processing will be done. Okay, and this is invented by Berkeley University, and this is said to be one of the latest commonly used wireless sensor networks in the IoT world. It's called Telos-B. Okay, the other name you call it also as T-mode module. Okay, and which we already do. Low power consumption is the main thing. Radio communication is the mode of communication. Okay. So, yeah, radio communication is the mode of communication used in Telos-B. Now, comparing Telos-B with the old version, MiCA-Z, I told you MiCA-Z is the old wireless sensor network. When you compare the operations of Telos-B with MiCA-Z, you can see that in case of Telos-B, could you just compare and tell me, sir, what is attracting you? I have made a comparison here. Could you just read the comparison? Tell me what is really attracting you between MiCA-Z and Telos-B?
Ma'am, this wake up time.
Very good, ma'am. Very good. You have a very good attention level. Fantastic. What else? There's one more.
Current consumption, 2.4 million.
Yes, sir. Fantastic, sir.
Power consumption. Therefore, power consumption will reduce.
So, this is suitable for which kind of IoT, sir?
Green IoT.
Fantastic, sir. You made my job as easy as possible. So, here you can see, little by little, when I'm talking about all these components, I'm also attaching the word green IoT. Are you following with me, sir?
Ma'am?
When I'm talking about all these components.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Certain components, I'm attaching the word green IoT. Are you following that up, sir?
No, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So, for example, when we discussed about actuators, we were talking about different actuators. Could you tell me what is the actuator that is best suited for green IoT?
Yes, ma'am.
The polymer IoTs.
Good, sir. Why reason, sir?
Ma'am, energy consumption less, and see, it is recyclable. It's a bioproduct.
Very good, sir.
No, it's a biodegradable as well.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, yes. Both of you are making my day fantastic.
This ma'am, you are giving knowledge like anything, ma'am. We are really very blessed with such kind of presentations, ma'am. Really.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for that.
I need your number, ma'am. Please, I want to contact you further after.
Yeah, sure, ma'am. I will give it to you at the end of the session, ma'am. Yes. So, comparing the MIKAs and TeleOSB, maybe in your normal IoT networks, you can go for MIKAs. But when you want to build a green IoT, the TeleOSB is most preferable one. The reason is, as both of them have rightly pointed, the first reason, sleep time. You know, all these sensors, when they're connected in the IoT, they don't be switched on all the time. Be it a normal IoT or be it a green IoT, these sensors will not be switched on all the time. Okay, they go into a state called sleep time, and then they come into a state called wake up time. Why they do this? Even in normal IoT, we have this, not only in green IoT. Why they do that is because of the energy efficiency. They don't want the energy to be wasted. Say, for example, you attach a camera in front of your house. You don't want the camera to be switched on all the time. Only when a movement occurs, the camera will switch on. Okay, so that is a kind of movement between sleep and wake up. So here, when you compare MIKAs and TeleOSB, the sleep, when during sleep time, even when it is sleeping, it will consume some current. Okay, and that is 30 milliamps, which is a huge value compared to TeleOSB, which will only be taking 2.4 milliamps. See that, ma'am, that's a minute comparison. In a place where 30 milliamps was used just during sleep, without doing any work, only for sleeping it uses 30 milliamps. But whereas when you replace it with TeleOSB wireless sensor network, it uses only 2.4 milliamps during sleep, which comparatively is very, very energy efficient. So I think TeleOSB, that's why I put the whole slide in green color to tell you that, you know, this is best suitable for green IoT. Similarly, another important thing about the sleep and wake up is it cannot afford to take time to wake up. As ma'am rightly said at the beginning, if it is IoT, it should be fast. Otherwise, no use in having an IoT. So see the wake up time. The wake up time in case of MIKAs is 60 microseconds, whereas it is only 6 microseconds. So see the major change is 60 and 6. Similarly, the active time also, the clock. It operates at 8 megahertz, which is the active clock, and here it is 4 to 8 megahertz. Okay, and also the data ratio and all that remains the same. But then if you want to go for energy efficiency and if you want to have a quick response, then TeleOSB is more preferred in green IoT compared to the normal IoT networks.
Ma'am, rather than going for a green IoT, this kind of technology, polymer sensors or like actuators, applicable like in mechanical way? If work is so hard, this polymer can take the
choose the right kind of polymers. Ma'am, they have not come up in a school shape right now. This is just an upcoming area. I've also attached some new things into the slides so that these polymer sensors are all coming up areas, actuators. Okay, ma'am, so
because after watching it's so delicate and that too in the industry, is it applicability is how much?
Ma'am, delicate is different, shape polymers is different. Delicate is meant for delicate applications like operations done, plucking a flower, plucking a fruit, that is delicate.
Okay.
Shape polymer is different, ma'am. You can make the actuators in any shape of a hand, shape of a machine, shape of a tool. Like that, ma'am.
Okay. So, in industry, this kind of...
Actually, there are some industries that are applying for authentic, to look nice, to have a good feel. They apply these shape actuators are actually used. For example, ma'am, you would have seen food industry in BBC channel or in
geography
channels.
Yes, ma'am. They have a very, very sophisticated kind of bottle picking and tap. And yeah, I saw that.
They have started using these shape actuators. Instead of
I was not knowing that it's a polymer. I mean, polymer, even this is new. This is very new concept for me. Okay. So I will go afterwards definitely to see what kind of polymer.
Please read.
So really, it is really very helpful.
Thank you. So coming to the core, we have already discussed about it everywhere in bits and pieces, but I want to put everything together, and I'm left out with exactly some 15 minutes to go, so I will complete the next.
And I need, sorry, ma'am, I need your this presentation, ma'am. It's really helpful for me for further.
I will share it with Lakshmi, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
You can get it from the coordinator.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, after this presentation, can I talk to you personally? I have some personal questions about concept only.
Yes.
Can I come up with?
Sure, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
So green IoT, we are going to go into green IoT. So as we were discussing about the entire concept of IoT, we saw each and everything, what are the differences, how it will be used and all that. Now, everything we have started thinking in, the saving our environment and, protecting it from especially unwanted emission of greenhouse effect, okay, reducing the greenhouse effect and so on and so forth, and greenhouse footprint reduction. So when you think IoT direction, then that IoT becomes a green IoT. So the definition, if you have to say, it's an energy efficient procedures have to be followed both in hardware and software. Okay, but you should also bring in the IoT characteristics. So you cannot compromise on the IoT characteristics, but without compromising that, we have to bring in a best solution, by reducing the greenhouse effect, gases, pollution, and all that. Okay, so that is the entire thing about green IoT. So coming to the let's now check out what are the green IoT enablers. If green IoT has to be brought into practice or brought into reality, what all things have to be done. This is again not my own description. I have taken it from an IEEE paper. I can also show you the IEEE paper from which I have made this, the next part of the presentation. The next remaining part of the presentation is I have done some research, especially for this presentation's sake, and thanks to Lakshmi ma'am, because of which I was enforced, to do this research, and I got a knowledge of myself. And what I'm presenting to you from this PowerPoint onwards is taken from that paper. The credit goes to that paper. So we can go for smart grid, smart airport, smart things, smart UAV, smart city, smart traffic, smart home, whatever. Okay, but what are the enablers, IoT enablers for introducing green IoT? Let us see. So coming into the concept that was discussed in that, through many papers, but I found this was very genuine because it's an IEEE paper and it had very good information. So I'm sharing that information with you. The paper, this presentation concentrates on the various five things. First is using green tags. You know what is a tag, right? We use RFID tags. So RFID tag has become one of the very common way of communication in normal IoT. But then how can it be replaced with green tags? So that is one topic. Second is green sensing networks. Third is green internet technologies, which could be replaced with the normal internet technology that is available. And what are the activities that can be standardized and made suitable for green IoT? And what are the challenges and opportunities that can be still made further better in green IoT? Okay, so this is how it's going to be the next few minutes of my presentation. Don't worry, I will finish it off by 10 or 12:15. So we know that RFID is one of the very promising wireless method by which IoT is enabled. So this is the RFID tags that you see commonly everywhere. They may be in different shape and size, but then RFID tags are important part of your IoT network. Your devices have
Hello, are you there, ma'am?
Hello, can you hear me? Sorry for that. There was some network interruption in between.
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you. Yes, ma'am.
Is my screen visible, sir? Is my screen visible now, right now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Clearly.
Okay. So this RFID tags, is. Can you tell me what is the two types of RFID tags? Hello?
Transmitter and receiver, ma'am.
Two types of RFID tags.
Active and passive tags.
Yes, active and passive tags. Very good. Two types of RFID tags are active and passive. Is my audio clear, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Now it's clear.
Thank you. So the two types are active and passive tags. Can somebody tell me what is the difference, ma'am, between active and passive?
Active, we need to power.
Only one simple difference. I'm changing power. the slide.
Power usage, ma'am.
Power, ma'am.
Power, charging.
Could you be more elaborate, ma'am? What is there in active tag but not there in passive tag? I'll put the question in a simple way.
Power
what
source.
Is there in active tag but not there in passive?
Power source.
Passive tag.
Very good. Power source. Very simple. Active tags do not have batteries. Okay, sir? But then your passive tags include batteries, right? So that is how the difference. But here, let's see how you go for smart tags. Okay, or the other name given in this paper is exactly green tags. So what is this green tag meant for is, green tag is the one that is mostly applied in green IoTs. Okay, this helps in reduction of, the energy consumption and so on and so forth. Very, very simple solution. So most of the time, a difficult problem will have a simple solution, right? Any difficult problem will have a simple solution. So the simple solution is, one, they have just reduced the size of the RFID tags. Instead of having a big size RFID tag, the Hitachi company was the first one to introduce this. They came out with a tag called micro tag. So instead of having a normal size RFID tags, they have come out with a very, very small size RFID tags, which are called micro tags. Okay, Hitachi was the first company. And its dimension is, less than 0.4 less than 0.4 millimeter square. And the other initiative is also very, very small initiative, but it has brought up a bigger change. The other initiative is the tags are made of biodegradable materials. So these are the kind of changes. The third change is these RFID tags are printable. Okay, you can print them whenever and wherever you need it. So they have also made printable tags and paper-based RFID tags, so which can be decomposed easily. And it's not going to cause any unwanted materials to be accumulated in the environment. Okay, so these are all some of the green solutions that from a RFID tag perspective, the changes have been brought about in order to implement green IoT. So let me repeat, the size of the tag is reduced. So we have micro tags, which are introduced by Hitachi, which is only 0.4 millimeter square in size. And biodegradable RFID tags are made. Printable RFID tags are made, paper-based RFID tags are made, okay, and you also have these, these are all providing green solutions to the RFID, okay. Let me give you a very interesting example. You have a very, very good application called as, I don't know, I forgot the name. So you have this food, when you go in to buy food that can be eaten as it is without cooking. For foreign countries, they rely much on these kind of food items, ready-made foods, right? Just buy them from the shop. Either you heat it in a microwave oven and eat it as such. So these kind of foods, especially when it is made of a non-vegetarian, the food, the quality of the food has to be tested, right? So there will be an expiry date at the outer cover of the food. But there are a lot of malpractices happening nowadays that they change the expiry date. Okay, they just tear off the label and stick a new label and say change the expiry date and then sell the food. So this is one of the major issues that could happen in the food industry. And when it is especially food given to babies, you have to be extra careful, isn't it? So now they have come out with a very recent application. I read through this in an IEEE paper. It was very interesting in an IEEE Spectrum magazine. The solution is there will be a tag, RFID tag, and that tag, you know, part of the tag will be inserted into the food packet. Suppose there is a packet, part of the tag will be touching or will be inserted into the food packet. And the remaining part of the tag will be exposed outside. So what you do is when you just have an application, you just have to scan that RFID tag, automatically real-time quality of the food will be sensed. Okay, the tag that is inserted will have some bacteria detection. So it will detect the bacteria level and the quality of the food, and then it will show you three colors: red, green, orange. Red means the food cannot be consumed at all. Throw it away immediately. Green means it is safe, perfectly safe to consume. Orange means it has to be consumed immediately. Okay, within a short time. You cannot store it at home and then consume it. So such kind of applications have started coming up, which is, you know, a kind of very good example for green IoT. So these should be biodegradable tags. They cannot be tags made of any, you know, material because it is inserted into the food. So they have started making paper-based tags for these applications. So these are the tags that are called eco-label tags. Tags used in food, tags used in, you know, other applications which are to be consumed by human beings. I hope you understood this concept. So that is called eco-label tags. So this is one of the very interesting solution that has been coming out in the area of, you know, green IoT. Next is the sensing network. We were talking about TelOSB as one of the example. I think that is, again, can be reminded here. So whenever you talk about WSN, wireless sensor network, I know you have to go for, when you switch over to green IoT, the kind of changes, I'm just you know, highlighting to you the kind of changes that has already been done by researchers. Okay, you can think of something new. Okay, so here what they have done is, as I told you about the TelOSB, now you understand why I compared the TelOSB with, you know, the, what is the other one? I forgot. TelOSB was compared with MIKAS. MIKAS Z. So we saw the word called sleep mode, right? And we saw what is meant by wake up time. So both that has to be improvised. So if you have a less energy to be utilized during sleep, and if you have a very fast wake up mode, then that kind of components are used to make your sensing networks. Then you get what is called a green IoT. Are you getting it? Yeah. And another small changes that has been done is, instead of using batteries, okay, instead of using electric batteries, and instead of using these normal batteries, which we use in normal IoTs, which consists of toxic substances. Batteries are actually made up of chemicals, isn't it? So they are actually toxic, cannot be used in food industry and all that. So when these batteries are replaced with, you know, the batteries made of, you know, other items like, you know, biodegradable items, and then start replacing the chemical component in the battery with something else, then, you know, you can have a better sensing network. And another is called, let me show you the next picture. Harvested energy. This is again a very, very new term that is used in green IoT, which is called harvested energy. Harvested energy means energy created on own. You harvest your own energy. So here you can see, suppose this is your TelOSB, your wireless sensor network. It will go into sleep mode, or it will switch over from sleep to active mode. When it is in sleep mode, it will not transmit anything.
when it switches over to active mode, it will be transmitting the data that it has collected. Okay, so this is how it actually works. This is a wireless sensor network. You can see there is a connectivity here. Now, for doing all this, it needs some energy. Okay, it needs some battery or some energy. What if this energy was harvested from a natural resource, say solar or wind or by movement, by gravitation, by different methods are there. Okay, what if that could be done? Then that is called harvested energy. So this is one of the very, very interesting concept of green IoT. So green IoT starts using some harvested energy instead of depending on a chemical battery or using a battery wherein there is a lot of other gases emitted and all that. Why don't we go for a harvested energy? This is again another example of where all the energy is being harvested so far. So you can get even energy by a vibration. Okay, you have now mobile chargers where you walk. Okay, when you walk, your body movement is sensed and that is given to a vibration sensor and that generates power for your mobile to be charged. So they are all self-efficient and harvested energy. Then thermal energy, heat, any form of heat can be converted into energy. Solar energy, wind energy, and radio frequency signals also can be used to harvest energy. So these are all the types of harvested energy that are being right now used. So energy harvesting sensor networks. This is another area where, the wireless sensor networks prefer to be used in green IoT. Whenever you want, imagine you have a battery in your mobile where, when you stand in the sun for 10 minutes and talk, your battery becomes 100% charged. Okay, that is not going to be an imaginary world. It's going to come in the future, very near future, right? So just stand in the sun and talk for 10 minutes, your battery becomes 100% charged. How fantastic it would be, right? So you need not use your electrical chargers. You need not be running around your charger. Okay, you have it everywhere. Then only your IoT becomes anywhere, everywhere concept, right? When you harvest energy and use it. So that is very, very fantastic concept. So you have green buildings, you can have green homes, you can have green data centers, green public services, green transport. Everything becomes real, real green. Okay. And coming to green internet technologies, yes, we here also almost the same kind of solutions are being used. We go for harvested energy. Okay. And this, I will share the slides with you. Okay. And it is like energy consumption is reduced. Okay, so choose and use all those devices which consume less energy, okay, which are adaptable for energy consumption and so on and so forth. Okay, without losing the quality of performance. I'm telling this again and again. Without using the quality of performance, choose and use only those devices which have less carbon dioxide emission, okay, which has less battery usage and so on. Yeah, so that is about, I will give you also some of the applications of green IoT. One of the very interesting applications is the patient tracking system, which has come out made of green IoT completely, which is existing right now. So you have real-time tracking and identification of patients, okay, which aims in tracking and monitoring the patients and the medical equipments also. Not only tracks the patients, it also tracks the equipments. Like say if an oxygen cylinder is attached or a ventilator is attached, it also tracks the equipments. Or if you have a pacemaker okay, attached or you have a brain, some devices attached in your brain, all that is tracked, okay, which I was talking to you already. And this IoT is now, have started using a lot of all that I said right now, green tags, green wireless sensor networks, RFID based tracking is made up of biodegradable RFID tags and so on and so forth. So they have started and they use something called as collaborative cluster heads. This is again a new word which is used especially by this application. You can see the name here. They use a kind of a concept called collaborative cluster head instead of using RFID tags. Okay, so instead of using sensors, for tracking, they use this collaborative cluster heads. Okay. Again, they say that this collaborative cluster heads are very, very energy efficient and they can harvest their own energy and so on. Instead of using a normal sensor, they use that. And they can even help us to identify wrong drug, wrong dosage. Okay, keep a track of the records of the patients. Infant identification. They say that this is one of the very interesting application of this concept. Identifying infants. Okay, to avoid mismatching of babies with their parents. That is something that very frequently happens in government hospitals. So this application can be used for infant identification. The slide may not be clearly seen to you, but I found that I should share the slide to you because this was a comparison done in this IEEE paper. Let me just tell you one or two points so that you will understand. So these are various applications. Say, for example, industry automation, health and living, habitat monitoring, which is smart agriculture, smart animals, and so on. Then smart cities. Then you have energy sector. Then transportation. So these are the major applications which have started moving from IoT to green IoT. Now, this table beautifully says, they will tell what all the methods used in communication, what is used for data storage, what are the devices used, what is the energy used. So earlier they were using batteries. For example, you take smart industry plant. Earlier the energy was battery. Now they have started moving towards harvesting energy. Are you getting? So this last column here says for achieving greenness. The column here reads achieving greenness. So for achieving greenness, what is the change they have made? So here they go for cloud computing and harvesting. Harvesting, I think you know the term now because we have seen what it is, harvesting energy. So instead of using battery, the batteries are replaced with harvested energy. Can be any type of harvest, solar, heat, wind, vibration, anything. Similarly, in the next application also, battery is replaced with harvesting. Third one, battery is replaced. Of course, harvesting is already done in smart plant monitoring. So now the normal internet is replaced with the cloud. Okay, so here these are the last column tells you how, what is the enabling IoT technology that helps them to move from normal IoT to green IoT. Okay, if you take green smart animals, they have completely started moving to harvesting because animals, they roam around in the sun, right? So why should you insert a battery for the sensors in the animals? Why can't you have a harvesting energy? Okay, so that is the kind of thinking that they have started making, and especially buildings, smart buildings, street lights can very well go for harvesting, smart waste, okay, smart environment, then smart grid. Okay, that is again a very upcoming area, smart grid, because when you have in future all Tesla cars, when they start coming up, you will be having all battery vehicles. So more the battery vehicles, more you will be in need of smart grids, you know, battery charging and all that. Then smart metering also has started moving towards green IoT applications. Smart parking. Okay, smart parking has started using harvesting energy. So this is the kind of very interesting comparison of IoT applications, which were earlier normal IoT, now have started using, green IoT. Okay, so you can, I think this will be a very interesting lesson. I've almost come to the end of my presentation. I will leave next 10 minutes for discussions. What are the lessons we have learned by switching over from normal IoT to green IoT? The first thing is, solutions are very, very simple. You saw that, RFID tag was just reduced in size. So simplicity, the ultimate acceptance and adoptions of many IoTs, that itself is, gives you big problem need not have a big solution. Okay, very, very simple. And your IoT also is actually made very simple of installation, easy to use by users. So you should not give up on all that. Just because you're converting from IoT to green IoT, I cannot give up on all this. I have to be keeping up all this, but then I have to move from normal to green IoT. Okay, and second lesson we learned is how can we change the sensing and inferring. Sensing is putting it into sleep mode whenever it is not used, and then waking up and then using a energy harvesting is the lesson that we learned in the case of sensing. In case of data collection, we collect data, but the data need not be used immediately. You convert it into meaningful results and then you do this data. So data is collected, and that is how fog was actually introduced. Fog is again a big change in IoT world, which helped in green IoT. If you had only cloud computing, that would have been very difficult. But replacing it with fog is a very interesting change. Then inference-free connectivity is going to lead to increased competition. Okay, various interferences are there. Okay, and they still operate in environments that will mitigate all these interferences from IoT devices. Okay, and impact on mobile applications. Yes, mobile is going to rule all of us. Already it has ruled, especially in this pandemic time and so on and so forth. So imagine a world without mobile. If it was the same pandemic some 10, 15 years back, life would have been even more miserable, right? But now we are able to cakewalk through this pandemic also because of availability of these mobile devices. So they are getting replaced with fast processors, cheap memory. Okay, the functionalities have started improving. They have started replacing many other devices. Okay, so the lesson learned is not only for green IoT, it's also for how IoT is helping us. Okay, it has made our life simple, sensing, data, interference free, and then a lot of mobile applications have started impacting. So that's it from my side, and I have completed my session. I would like to take up a few questions, if there are any, from the participants.
Yeah, if any one of you would like to interact, you can have interaction. You can unmute, you can have interaction. Thank you, madam. Lot of appreciation have come in the chat window already. And people are asking for your PPT as well. Because they got excitement, I think so that they are asking for your PPT. So really interactive with activities as well as the inputs which you have given related to especially sensor is unique from all other sessions. However, we touched upon sensors in all the session. You have brought lot more collections, lot more hardware related information. That is a unique highlight of your session. I really appreciate. That is where we were finding little bit of a gap. I thought you have fulfilled. Even I didn't even discuss with you what is the agenda of your session. However, the exact gap is filled by you. That is awesome. The filling you did it for this fulfillment of this AICT workshop. Really, it is going very well. Every resource person seems to be a pearl, and everybody is contributing and showcasing their own expertise. That also there is no overlap. That is the way we also arrange. That is the way it is going on also. The entire session ending with you, madam. Afternoon, we are going for valedictory with the chief guest, deputy director of UGC. So you are the last resource person of this STTP. So we would like to get associated with you as well for our future endeavor. Really thank you for accepting the notification from our end and a wonderful and awesome presentation, I can say. We started with wonderful presentation. We ended with wonderful presentation. That is the highlight. You energized also. You energized the participants as well. That is another highlight, I can say. Interactive session, energizing audiences and activity, and the content is flooded with a lot of information. That is a highlight. Thank you all. Thank you, madam. Thank you for being with us for the half day session.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, I want to get an enlightened in authentication and authorization, if you care something. Your ideas about the IoT devices.
Ma'am, and is it a question to me, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry. Can you please repeat the question, ma'am? I was not aware of the question.
Authentication, authorization services related to IoT. She wanted to have a glimpse.
Okay.
And authorization deep if you have.
you want to know what are the kind of authentications that are right now followed in IoT, ma'am? Is that the question?
As well as authorization, both, yeah. Both, ma'am, authentic.
Yes. Ma'am, when you use some protocols, like, you know, when you use a protocol called MQTT, which I was talking to you about earlier, that is one of the common protocol that is used in IoT network. So MQTT actually works on a basis called client-server. That is the basis of operation of MQTT, client-server mode. So there will be a client and there will be some servers. Sorry, there will be a server and there will be some clients. So this server will only send information to the clients. Client cannot directly communicate with another client. Okay, ma'am? So that is one of the best thing in MQTT. The other name for MQTT, you can call it as publisher and subscriber. The publisher is a client who wants to send message. Subscriber is a client who wants to receive message. So what this MQTT will do, ma'am? MQTT has got a central hub known as MQTT broker. Okay, ma'am? Example of MQTT broker is called Mosquito Broker. That is one of the name of Mosquito name broker that is recently used in IoT. It's called Mosquito Broker. So what this Mosquito Broker will do, when a device wants to send a message, that is when it wants to publish, it will check, authenticate the device, the message, the data, everything, only then allow for sending data. Similarly, when a device wants to receive also, the broker will authenticate the device, authenticate the message, authenticate the data. Only then it will allow the data to be shared with the subscriber. So this is one example of how, you know, authentication can be brought about in case of IoT network. Okay, so MQTT will solve the purpose to some extent. I cannot say fully, 100% there is no solution so far. You can maybe find it out. But then to some extent, it solves the solution. I hope I answered your question, ma'am.
And about authorization?
Pardon? Authorization, same thing. When I said identification, see, actually, when you use MQTT broker, it does four things. It will identify, it will authenticate. Identification is authorization, right? Identify, authenticate. It will establish a connection, also terminate the connection. That is very important about MQTT. It will not just make a connection and go away. It will also terminate the connection because same connection should not be misused by any other device. Okay, ma'am?
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Dear participants, let us conclude the morning session because we need to join for the valedictory by 2 to 2:10 with the UGC Deputy Secretary. We are going with the valedictory. Soon after the valedictory session, you will be given the feedback form for both of the sessions. Only one session. For the valedictory, you cannot give feedback. So only for the one session. Afternoon, we will be sharing the feedback as well as we'll be sharing the quiz, 25 MCQ quiz form for the STDP certification. So for that quiz, you can start by 4 o'clock, you can end up by 5 o'clock. Soon after the valedictory, you can relax for some time. Subsequently, you can take part in the Google form. But that will be closed by 5 o'clock only. No need to hurry up, no need to be tensed. Both the feedback form as well as the Google form will be shared in the WhatsApp group as well as in the session itself. Nothing to worry about it. Really, I thank Dr. Brinda Madam to ending with the energetic session again, because towards end it will be fading. The participants energy as well as the entire workshop will go towards the end of the signal, but you have energized with again peak moments. So again it is going with a better energy level. That is a highlight I could see today. So thank you for being with us.
Energetic participants.
Yeah. Both way, the session resource person also should energize. Only then they will be excited. Otherwise, they will be in the neutral state. So it is both way it went well. So really, I do enjoy it. Only half an hour I was picked away. I was involved with that Google Forms, these all matter for the afternoon session. And reading through the profile of the chief guest, these are all the things I was involved. Other than that, I was attending your session, thoroughly enjoyed. Nice. After a long time, we are connected. Yeah.
Yes, I cherish every moment. That's why I said.
Yeah.
Like, ma'am, I just have a small request from my side.
Yeah.
I'm just doing a small research, ma'am. for especially about the effect of COVID-19 on teachers.
Ma'am, we will be including you in the group as one of the admin. You can communicate whatever you wish. There are two resource persons. They wanted to be with the participants for sharing their stuff. So instead, we are taking from you. Yeah, we taking from you and communicating. We will include you in the admin group of two. We have two group. So in both of the group, I will include you. Any moment, any material sharing, anything you can come forward, anything you can communicate. That's
fantastic, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So I will share my PPT also in that group.
Yeah, that's fine. Fantastic. Yeah.
Thank you, Lakshmi, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Have a nice lunch and have a nice day.
Yeah, bye, ma'am. See you.
Yeah, bye-bye. See you.
Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Thanks. Thank you, though, sir. Thank you very much.
You are really very resourceful, ma'am, and we are glad that we found when we got the connectivity with you through this STTP.
Thank you, ma'am. I also and cherish.
We are very blessed. We are very blessed with your knowledge, and I'm telling you, I've learned so many new things today, and I'm going to come up to you afterwards also to understand some of the concepts which is really new for me even. And thank you, ma'am, for such great guidance from bottom of my heart.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Bye. See you all, dear participants and organizers.
Yeah, bye, ma'am. Bye-bye. Bye. Dear participants, please join us by 2-2-2-5 at least. So there is a valedictory session. With that, we will be concluding the STTP. You need to join. By that way, you'll be getting all the links, quiz link, feedback link, not now. End of the valedictory only, everything will be done. Because today it is not the session, it's going to become valedictory. So in between, please don't disturb also. I'll be into moderation. So kindly cooperate and your links will be shared both in the WhatsApp as well as in the Google Meet, Zoom Meet. So it will be given, nothing to worry. So you need to join the valedictory session. Subsequently, it will be shared.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you all.